The students incorporate their other learning areas into the media lab by deciding within their learning centres what direction they want to take their filming, whether it's a documentary, a narrative, an informal report. They do their research, they write their scripts, create their storyboards, all before they walk into the media centre. This equipment was purchased for the students to use, so they have full responsibility of using it. We trust them to work independently in the media centre. They know the teachers they can come and talk to if they need help with any technical problems, but they're fantastic in using it on their own. They've got full control. We've got a program called Boinks. It's a software program that allows us to broadcast throughout the school. We've got students that are trained up in that area and that can use that independently. We've got camera boys that are just so great on the camera. The recording studio students can use that independently. They use a program called GarageBand, and that helps them to make whatever they want for whatever purpose they need. We also have radio station students that range from grade 1 through to grade 6 that can use a radio station independently as well. They also create songs, sound effects in the recording studio. We've got editing suites behind us where they can use either Sony Vegas or Windows Movie Maker to create their movies. It's great because of the background, having the green screening, it can take their learning anywhere they like.
My name is Ray Trotter. I'm principal of Warana Park Primary School. The recent focus on stimulating learning platforms in the form of a dragon boat and spaceship has been very significant in the schools. We're now involved in a research project with lecturers from Monash University in evaluating the learning that is coming from these SLPs. I mean, you've got a situation with the dragon boat that the children have a steering wheel with two screens. One has a compass and one has Google Earth on it. And the children will plan their journeys around the world. And they'll ask questions at a very young age, like, how far is it to New Zealand? How long will it take if we're going this speed? And so the level of discussion relevant to mathematics and literacy and all sorts of areas of interest to the children is very, very significant. And while it's very imaginary to children, it's made us rethink just what an authentic learning environment is for children, because it can be totally imaginary. Mm. Now, for me, this has pushed me even further to think about just what kind of school we could have in the future. About a year ago, I read a book by a man called Richard Gerber, and I gravitated to the book because Ken Robinson wrote the foreword. And of course, he's the great educationalist that talks about creativity, etc. And in the book, Richard talks about the need for schools to be as exciting as Disney World. Why can't schools be exciting as Disney World? And that intrigued me. And the more I thought about it, the more I thought, well, what sort of school would Walt Disney build? And I eventually went to the staff and asked them to tell me three words that would describe a school that Walt Disney built. And I don't have to use the words, because everybody can come up with exciting words that describes a school built by Walt Disney. For me, why can't we build this school?
If you've got your photos on your phone...
I'm Jared Lampshed. I'm a Year 6-7 teacher of an all-boys class.
OK, then.
Hackamese Primary School is in the southern suburbs of Adelaide, fairly low socio-economic area. Took pages documents. In 2006, all staff all attended a workshop run by Ian Lillico. He's a boys education expert Australian based in Perth. The following year, I was team teaching, and we were determined, I guess, to try some of those strategies to see whether it really did make a difference.
Okay, guys, we have community circle. Please bring your chair down.
Positive culture in the classroom with boys is vitally important. We try and set up a learning environment where the whole class comes together as a team.
Yeah, quick as we can.
We have a community circle set up that where the kids come together and they really manage their behaviour themselves.
Okay, so we'll start having a look at the problems we've got.
It takes a lot of work.
Toby, you're first up. Can you tell us, remind us why you're out?
I'm out because I put myself out because I don't think I've been completely on task, and I think I've been like distracting my, getting distracted and maybe distracting others a little bit.
Okay, would you like some feedback?
Oh, yes, please.
It's not a punitive consequence-based program.
Well, I think it's been going really good.
It's about getting together and talking through those issues rather than just throwing detentions at them.
Job with Andre, like helping and stuff.
Yeah, I reckon you've been really good and you should move back in.
It diffuses anything before it really begins to build up.
What would you like to see happen today?
I'd like to go in.
All those in favour?
Aye.
There's an important process though that we finish with a positive at the end of that. First year, 75 detentions before they were in the single-sex class. And they had 5 by the end of that first year. So there's a drop of 70 detentions amongst the group.
I'd like to acknowledge Andre for staying calm during this session.
The physical layout of our classroom is very different to what other classrooms are like in the school. We've been looking at the work of Stephen Heppel and trying to set up our learning spaces a little bit differently. We have round tables set up in a cafe style so that they're forced to sort of be facing each other and talking about that. That obviously has to go along with some engaging learning tasks, otherwise they're going to sit around and talk about what was on TV last night. We've got kids sitting on cushions on the floor around a coffee table and they're much more productive. A lot of boys focus really well if they've got a task to do with having some headphones in and being able to listen to some music while they're learning.
Yeah.
We're looking at kids engaging through having online blogs, and that's about one of Lilico's recommendations to show the boys a purpose for their learning and give them a real audience. Obviously, once that behaviour is under control, the learning picks up as well. Seeing lots of good data and looking at work samples, the difference was huge. So, where do you want to start? Do you want to, what are you doing at the moment?
I'm going to be looking at a maths investigation to finish off the rest of the term.
As a single-sex team, we meet on a fortnightly basis. My role is really to lead that discussion, I guess.
What I'm planning at the moment to do is actually look at a game of chance.
In the planning session, we were looking at some maths topics and really just make them more engaging.
Have you got like links to like a real life situation and things like that?
I do. It's going to be based on a school fair where they have to make a game of chance.
It's about just drawing out the conversation.
They won't be static in their seats.
With the hands-on stuff, the other thing you can probably do, make the games, you know, make the boards up and do those sorts of things, and probably comes away from the maths then a bit. But you're looking at cross-curricular links, then it can go to, you know, some design and tech stuff.
Definitely. For me, watching the program grow has been excellent. I mean, I think it's
with the recommendations from Ian Lilico that having a purpose for learning is really important.
We made zero money.
We've slowly built to where we are now, which is we've got a single-sex stream for boys and girls from year 2 through to year 7. Through the way that the boys behave now and through the way that they present themselves and the skills that they've learned through being part of this program, I have a group of boys that come with me twice a year and we present a lecture at UniSA. So they're now able to take that next step and share their learning with the next generation of teachers. And to be able to get that message out there from their perspective, it's not just me standing there going on about how good I think it is. The kids are now starting to be involved in that, to show an understanding of how they're learning and how that this sort of program is affecting who they're becoming.
My name is Marilyn Pitt. I'm a teacher at Centralian Senior College. I teach in the Gateways program. The Gateways program is for students predominantly of Indigenous backgrounds. They are all students who are either ESL, English being a second, third or fourth language, or they're speaking English as an EADL language. The approach in Gateways is a cooperative community family type approach.
Let's just get it in the voice first though, in the mouth. School education preparation for life.
School education preparation for life.
Equal life chances are human right.
Equal life chances are human right.
One mob.
We teach mainstream type subjects, but from a different point of view with a different emphasis, which is more culturally meaningful for the students that we're working with.
I liked what you just said to him, stand up, yeah, like at the grand final. Like, I'm just suggesting it's not a bad image to put into your lyrics.
Oh, well, I need Dan to help me with that. He's good.
But just write the word idea down.
The integrated learning subject, I've chosen to use an authentic real-life context to build the whole program around, and that context is the Generation One, a nationwide competition that involves creating some kind of response to the idea of ending Indigenous disadvantage in one generation. In the process, we're working with a hip-hop artist who is quite gifted in assisting the students. Students that are quite shy and reticent to express their view, their opinion, he's very good at assisting them to draw that out of themselves and have a voice.
Fella black, fella, let's close the gap. Make it one generation across the map. Let's all come together as one. You feel that?
I have, in fact, noticed students who are fairly disengaged usually spend a lot of time with their headphones on. Instead of listening to music, they're actually producing music. This was one of the intentions of the program, was to turn these students from passive recipients of IT into active creators.
Oh, that's fantastic! That's like jazz. That is beautiful. That is so. Oh, you got more?
I think it's very important for students to have different learning contexts outside of the classroom context. We regularly have excursions. I do my best to find some outside experience that we can have.
The impact that's had on those quieter students has really brought them out of their shell as well. Yeah. Students who wouldn't normally be up there with the microphone engaging or want to do public speaking, those are the students that have probably benefited, do you think, the most?
Yeah, definitely. And today was great because we went to the ABC radio studio and we actually had those kids that you're talking about, the really reticent speakers, there with the mic and the headphones and talking their stories at and again, real-life, authentic situations. So it just does something to them. In a classroom, they will shut down, but in a real-life context, it starts to make them more connected and want to communicate more.
There are a lot of issues in Alice Springs, but I don't get involved in that stuff. All I do is worry about my sports and my family. I don't need to be racist and fight against people. All I need to do is go along with my life in a positive way and end my future.
Stand up for your culture, stand up and be candid. If you want to be heard, you better shout it. Indigenous, Australian, dancing, creative.
I feel very passionate about the need to have authentic experience in the school context for students, particularly students whose cultural backgrounds are dissimilar from the background of the culture of the school. School can sometimes be quite disconnected for students from the rest of their life. But if they're engaged in authentic experience at school, there's a real connect between what the school is offering and what their lives are offering them.
My name is Sue Og and I'm teaching here at Lowood and I have a 5-6 multi-age class. We have 320 children. We have a fairly transient population. Lowood has a special ed program, so I have 9 children who are verified with a disability. But in return, I get a special ed teacher or a teacher aide to work with me. So we'd been doing lots of work on place value, and so really what I was hoping with this inquiry was to check that they had a deep understanding of what we had been working on.
10,000.
100,000.
Oh, 10 million?
Not yet. Times in by 10. 1.
10.
100.
When we're asking a question such as how much is a million, the beauty of inquiry is I'm not saying to them, I want you to show me a million using MAB blocks. How could you do it? I'm not saying to them, I want you to show me a million in groups of 10 or anything. I'm just saying to them, how much is a million? And it's up to them whether they want to be, how creative they want to be with that and how much depth they want to go into with that question. That you can give them worksheets, you can ask them questions, and if you keep asking them in a certain way, you get the right answer, but it's not until you actually let them explore the concept that you find all these misconceptions and that they really don't understand it as well as they thought they did, or as well as I thought they did.
Okay, so we can do 1.5 and then divide it by a third, and then we should get 1.5 divided by 1/3 equals. I don't think that's right. Okay, so.
I find inquiry is very good for differentiation. In that inquiry that we did then, I gave the paddle pop sticks to the children that were less able and the grains of rice to the kids that I thought would be able to cope with that a little bit better. The grains of rice was a little more abstract. With the paddle pop sticks and the buttons, there was that possibility that they could do that successfully by counting. It might not necessarily have been the fastest way, but it was a possibility. But if I'd given them the grains of rice, they would have counted the rice. And I'm not sure if they would have, on their own, thought of doing it another way. Qua, what was your idea?
Counting.
So counting. You thought you'd just count one by one? Just go 1, 2, 3. Yes. How long do you think that would take?
I think it'd take 2 hours or something.
You think it would take 2 hours to count that?
7 hours.
The children who have been doing this for a long time know there's no right, there's no wrong way of doing it. There are easy ways, there are hard ways. But there's no right way or wrong way.
Yellow lids of it and count how much was in one lid.
Yep.
And that's 440.
Yep.
So we're going to count how much lids were in there, which so far I've got 9.
Okay.
And then we're going to times it by however much lids there was.
In terms of the children who have trouble with maths, I often find that inquiry, it's a positive way of looking at maths. It's often the first time that those kids do something, and because I say to them, well, where's the maths in it, that they think, oh, this is maths, oh, this is fun. But they usually have this feeling that I'm no good at maths, maths is hard, you know, it's no use. And it's just, I find with the inquiry, it builds up a love of the subject.
My name is Prima and I teach Indonesian at Heathmont Secondary College, which is located in the southeastern part of Melbourne. This school comprises of about 650 students who are largely of monocultural and monolingual background. I put together an intercultural approach called the cultural task-based design. In this approach, students are given options on learning tasks and also in how they wish to present their learning outcomes. Providing choices gives them a sense of ownership of their learning. Yes.
Namaste, Damon.
Namaste, James.
Namaste, Jaden.
This learning design proved to be quite successful with increasing interest, continuity and retention in the study.
Mata pelajaran favorite saya matematika.
Saya suka belajar bahasa Indonesia.
My name is Jill English. I'm the principal at Heathmont College. The Bridge program that Prima has been successful in securing the funding for our school, absolutely a wonderful program. And we've been able to, through this project, develop a sister school relationship that has meant that our teachers and their teachers have developed very close relationships. Our students are developing close relationships with the students of our sister school, and it really is assisting to break down those cultural barriers and helping all our staff to understand more about the Asian culture and Asian languages in particular.
Ben, maybe from here with advocacy and the Malaysian tour, just remember to Skype back from Malaysia to your students who are here so that the rest could also experience what...
I'm currently working on a mentoring project with two teachers from Highview College. They are Ben and Carissa, and they are lovely, young, passionate beginning teachers with such energy. It's such a privilege for me to harness this energy and to channel them to the right ways on how to get the best out of them and also the best for their students. I liaise with them via emails, online chats, wiki spaces, and I try to work with them to achieve their goals, which they have set. They have actually set very high goals.
My focus has been looking at retention rates. We have electives for Indonesian in Year 9, 10, 11 and 12, and we find that there's a big drop-off in Year 8, especially with the boys. So I've decided to concentrate on engaging male learners in the language classroom.
My goals for the future, I'm looking at, I suppose as an overall school thing, I'm looking personally at creating a sister school relationship with a school in Indonesia to try to improve, obviously, the students' contact with Indonesia and get some real experiences there.
When they see achievement and evidence from what they have done, this really encourages them to go on. And I have seen such great things that these two students, these two new teachers have done in their schools. Ben is very excited over what he's doing for advocacy. He has put up a lot of stuff in his school newsletter. Such mentoring projects are really an excellent way for both beginning teachers and also experienced teachers like us, because it takes us out of our comfort zone to see what great things we can still go on doing for our students. You guys will do well. I'm sure you guys will do well.
We will do our best, definitely.
Hello, Mary, how are you? I'm good, thank you. I've just got all the stuff that you needed for your Indonesian day for tomorrow. I'll bring a few students also. I'm currently convening the cluster school program involving my school and our four feeder primary schools. All the principals have come on board, and here we are developing a continuous curriculum across levels 4 and 5. This is to support a seamless transition for students between the primary and secondary school. And teachers come together to develop curriculum, share practices, discuss and help each other out. The primary school students have a taste of what secondary Indonesian is all about, and my students will have a platform to use their learning and their expertise. I really value the support that I get from my school leadership, because without that, it would not have been possible to run the many various language programs that I have been doing for my students.
So as you guys know, we've been studying volume. So what is volume again?
Volume is the space within a 3D shape.
My name's Betsy Hustler. I am a grade 4-5 teacher at Ross Park Primary in Alice Springs. We're a school with a lot of different cultures and a mixture of different students from different places. I select and use resources that cater for a lot of the learning needs of my class. I've noticed that a lot of the kids can pick things up a lot easier if they're able to build something and then visualise how it is after it's been built. The mathematical outcomes that I'd like to achieve in this lesson is that children are able to work out the formula for volume. So our scenario is that Mrs. Blanchfield has asked us to provide her with 6 cubic metres of balloons for the spring fair. All right, so how do you think that we'd work this out? Ruby?
We could make a cubic metre.
The resources that I've chosen will be the group task role cards. I think that they're really important to have an allocated role for the children to make sure that there's accountability for one and everyone knows that they've got something that they need to be doing and they need to be taking ownership of. What's your job, Nathan?
I am a leader.
You're a leader. Wow, what do leaders usually do? After that, I'll be explaining the resources to them, so I've provided them with some newspapers, which I'm expecting that they'll roll up to make their cubic metre. I've given them straws, they're going to have 1 metre ruler, and there's going to be some sticky tape and some cellophane, and they will be problem solving together to decide how they can construct this cubic metre with things that aren't actually a metre long. So it will be a challenge for them, and they'll have to problem solve on the way.
All right, now we just need 2 more poles, so then we can get the top.
Need some help, Ruby?
Yeah, I might need help. Are we making it so, like, it's a box? Like, yeah. You can go inside of it?
Okay, well, we should use cellophane.
We will use cellophane. Write that down.
The best thing I find having the iPads in the class as a teacher is it gives me some anecdotal evidence to actually see afterwards. I'm not there for all of the conversations with the children and how they constructed their things. So I can collect in the iPads and then I can sort of reflect and assess based on what I've seen in there. It's always good to assess the kids not just on a addition algorithm or something like that. It's the thought processes that went behind everything rather than just a finished product.
Well, I reckon we should use the bamboo sticks because they would be really good for support.
We could use the four at the bottom and then use one to go to the top so we know how high to make everything else.
The next step with me as a teacher is using the resources that we've actually made as a classroom. What we'll do tomorrow or maybe the next day is we'll use our cubic meters and we'll discuss how many cubic meters might fit in this classroom and work it out based on my actual hands-on learning. We know that there are how many balloons in one cubic meter by working out the volume.
You times 100 by 6 and that's 600, then you times the 25 by 6 and that's 150.
I think the kids' understanding with maths went really well today. It wasn't just addressing the formula that we needed for volume. It was also assessing what materials they were going to use to make 1 metre, what and how they were going to use these informal tools to actually make what they needed to make. I feel that having really hands-on, exciting activities really makes kids want to come to school. Something that seems quite small for you is a really big deal for the kids and they really look forward to actually doing it and working with their friends and having a good time.
Hi, my name's Sarah Combin. I'm a Year 1 teacher at St Saviour's Primary School in Toowoomba. My class consists of 28 students. We have students from a range of different backgrounds with a range of different needs. Our project today in Grade 1 has come from actually a visit from a local author. He had the children make creatures and the children were really engaged in this, so I've decided to take it to the next level. We've used these creatures with a literacy focus, so we've brainstormed with the children what type of writing they would like to do. They can do a poem, they can write descriptions, they can write stories, and they've all chosen different things to do.
Now the thing is, Matt, your hand is in the way, so what were you guys thinking about doing?
String.
Okay, well you better go and grab some fishing line. Okay, Christian, if you race over to the art and craft area, you'll be able to grab some fishing line.
As well as that, then we've talked in class about how they want to present their work. So some children have decided to do a shape poem using the interactive whiteboard to help them. Others have decided to create their creature out of plasticine and they're making an animation on an iPad. There's other children who are doing an oral story and they're video recording each other on the iPads and then making an iBook. And we've also got children using Photo Story to write a description about their creatures. They've all been so excited about it and there hasn't been any behaviour issues because they're really engaged in what they're doing and it's given them the opportunity to own their learning.
All the other creation ancestors came out from behind the trees to see what the fuss was about. They looked into the sky and then they saw Brolga flying away with a coolerman. What is a coolerman? Can anyone remind me what it is?
My name is Freya Lucas and I've been teaching at Tom Price Primary School for 4 years now.
Give me the boomerang, said Frog. He put down his hunting spear and threw the boomerang with his right hand, but he missed.
I am a Year 4 classroom teacher at the moment. I also deal with a lot of the SAYAR students, the students at educational risk.
How about you, Jewel?
Tom Price is 1,600 kilometres from Perth.
What do you use the boomerang for?
Hit kangaroos.
Oh, do you? So you go hunting just like they do and you throw it. What about you?
I use the Dreamtime stories because if I'm telling a Dreamtime story, they can relate their own story.
So what do we need to include when we write our story?
So it helps me teach by their knowledge.
Punctuation.
Orientation.
I did a ESL course last year, which focuses on the different dialects of Aboriginal English.
And they're going to do theirs into the small microphones with Mrs. Hart.
And how to incorporate all different lessons within in the classroom, which brought out more vocabulary.
So what is it about?
Birds.
And what happened?
They paint themselves.
And then they change their
colour.
Colour.
Oh, and there's a lot of literacy experiences, a lot of things before the writing.
Big snake will come up and ruin the town, they'll take over the town.
I'm Kath Hart, the Aboriginal Education Coordinator and ICT coach.
Bibby and he doesn't like Bibby.
When I'm working with staff, I try and integrate ICT as much as possible. So I have introduced the use of video cameras and recordable buttons where you can record voice for up to 30 seconds. And we also have some USB microphones.
I made a story about the jungle and the daddy.
They have such great ideas and great stories which they can verbally tell.
The daddy hated the jungle, so they had a race to the sun.
And then as they are writing it down, they can just play it back and go where they're up to in their story.
I made a story about the jungle and the daddy.
And it gives them the opportunity to be able to sound out their word. It gives them the opportunity to look on a chart and to find what that letter would look like and then be able to represent it in their writing.
I find it's very useful for assessment as well, to use video and audio, so the students can look back at it the next week and say, oh, I didn't do that, and notice for themselves what needs to be improved.
Do you want to listen to make sure what bit you got?
Yeah.
OK. Go.
Also, it's very hands-on, so it's not just sitting at a desk and writing. They learn better by playing games in small groups. And what works for Aboriginal children usually works for all other children as well.
Can I have the people with the microphones to carefully put them on my desk? We're going to do that nice and quietly, aren't we?
Yeah.
Go.
I'm Anita Trenwith. I teach at Salisbury High School predominantly in special education. So I work with students from year 8 to 13 in special education with a focus on science but also some sign language as well and agriculture under the branch of science. So Salisbury High School is a northern suburbs school north of Adelaide. We have about 1,000 students here. We have a number of students in special education, approximately 50, and we have a special education unit within a mainstream school environment. Today I was talking with Ali, who I've been working with from Mount Gambier High School, so that's part of a mentoring project. And one of the things we were talking about today is they teach a forensics unit at Mount Gambier High School, and so I was just showing her what we have done when we've taught forensics at Salisbury High School, and also in particular what I've done when I've taught forensic science in special education. So actually looking at what we do, how I've changed the mainstream worksheets and booklets into something that's achievable literacy-wise for our special education students, and how I've made it more user-friendly for special education students in terms of the way the book's presented, even though the content effectively is still the same.
So could you see yourself being able to adjust some of the work that you do to cater more for some students within your own cohort?
Yeah.
At your school?
Yeah, I think so. Especially these booklets, we actually teach forensic science in science for year 8, 9 and 10. And we've got lots of students with literacy problems, so it'd be really helpful to be able to make up a booklet like this that they could use instead of just giving them the textbook where they have to read the whole method and then watch me demonstrate it. It would be good to be able to just show them a few steps that they can follow.
Well, today we were looking at one of my special education classes doing an activity where we were learning about muscles and bones. And so our focus today was muscles, and we're starting to look at, are all muscles in the body the same? Are some of them stronger than others? Are some of them different? How do they work? The fact that they work in pairs. So bringing some of that theory in, but at the same time sneaking in some scientific method, because we did a simple experiment where they had to hold weights out and compare which hand could hold the weight longer. But then we actually, next lesson, we'll talk about, is that the most accurate way to actually compare your left and right arm strength? What are some of the things that could make it an uneven test?
Do you think this is the most accurate way we could work out if one arm is stronger than the other?
Yes.
So if I had to report to my doctor and tell him which arm was stronger, this is how I would test it? Mm. Or can we think of a way that might be more accurate? Because some people had some unusual results. Ryan, what was your result?
So is there anything in particular that you think that I'd be able to help with as well? Because obviously then we can sort of work as a team to actually support getting some ideas up.
Just have a look at some of the examples that you've got here, because we have the same worksheets at our school there.
Yeah.
We've never seen it formatted and changed like this at all. And so,
Just
the way you've simplified the key points, the key ideas, spread out some of the tasks so it doesn't look as daunting for the students.
I think it was great to hear that she actually could see herself using some of the ideas in what she was using already, and when she was talking about, because it's not just about special education, there's students within mainstream classes that actually have literacy difficulties, and so you can use some of these strategies with students even if they're not in special education. You might not simplify it quite so much, but you can still create different levels of the same task so that it's achievable to different levels of literacy. And it was really nice to hear that she could already picture ways that she could use this with her own students that have literacy issues in her own classes.